So we are continuing, as I said before, in 1 Corinthians 14, coming up to the end of the book. We're in the second half of chapter 14 this morning. It is all about how we approach this Sunday worship gathering together or other similar gatherings that we have as a church. And it's all kind of about order. So the title of the message this morning is City Order. We are looking at 1 Corinthians 14, verses 26 through 40. There's a link at the bottom of your bulletin. If you grabbed one, you can punch that into your phone. Otherwise, it will be right behind me, or you can hopefully find it in your physical Bible as well. So 1 Corinthians 14, starting in verse 26. What then, brothers, when you come together, each one has a hymn, a lesson, a revelation, a tongue, or an interpretation. Let all things be done for building up. If any speak in a tongue, let there be only two or three, most three, and each in turn, and let someone interpret. But if there is no one to interpret, let each of them keep silent in the church and speak to himself and to God. Let two or three prophets speak, and let the others weigh what is said. If a revelation is made to another sitting there, let the first be silent, for you can all prophesy one by one so that all may learn and all may be encouraged. And the spirits of prophets are subject to prophets, for God is not a God of confusion, but of peace, as in all the churches of the saints. The women should keep silent in the churches, for they are not permitted to speak, but should be in submission, as the law also says. If there is anything they desire to learn, let them ask their husbands at home, for it is shameful for a woman to speak in church. Or was it from you that the word of God came, or are you the only ones it has reached? If anyone thinks that he is a prophet or spiritual, he should acknowledge that the things I'm writing to you are a command of the Lord. If anyone does not recognize this, he is not recognized. So, my brothers, earnestly desire to prophesy. And do not forbid speaking in tongues, but all things should be done decently and in order. This is the word of the Lord. Interesting passage today. You're probably already looking at one part of that, but we'll get to that in a bit. But I think if you know, if I know the common man or the common woman today in Los Angeles or even in our country, there's a lot of people, and we have a recall election going on as well right now, there's a lot of people who are very sick of the dysfunction and partisan bickering that can happen back and forth in politics, right? Anyone else feel that way? I think we're probably in a place where the majority of Americans get very tired of seeing politicians arguing back and forth on TV in the various ways that they can. Perhaps you might be some sort of political nerd and you love watching something like C-SPAN and you enjoy watching the U.S. Senate or the U.S. House of Representatives kind of go back and forth in the way that they do. Sometimes the partisan bickering can be on such display and is almost probably done a lot of it for the cameras in our own governing bodies that it can really get out of order. When it gets really bad, it can be hard to maintain order if both sides are just going back and forth at one another. But if you think our own American politics, our own American houses of governing are bad and can get out of order, have you ever seen the British House of Commons in action? It's a whole nother level. You think we bicker and fight back and forth? I'm going to show you if it works. We're having some audio issues, but hopefully it'll work out. This morning, I'm going to show you a clip from 60 Minutes showing what recently the British House of Commons was like, and then we'll come back after that clip.
Order! Order!
He may demand it, but order has been in short supply lately at the Palace of Westminster.
Be a good boy, young man! Be a good boy!
Thought partisan politics was an exclusively American issue? Take a look at the mother of parliaments.
I have to say, Mr. Speaker, I've never heard such humbug in all my life. Because
you'd be forgiven for thinking you'd walked into a street fight with considerably nicer upholstery.
This Prime Minister to talk about morals and morality is a disgrace!
Order!
It falls to the Speaker, John Bercow, to preside.
Oh,
Unlike Nancy Pelosi, this speaker doesn't usually vote. His job, keeping, well, order. In theory, anyway.
Now I order!
Can we get you a gavel?
They make those. Would that make your job easier?
I'm not sure it would, and it's very un-British to have a gavel in the chamber. Although there is a general requirement of brevity, most people, doubtless myself included, think that we are being briefer than we are, and most people are in favour of brevity as long as it is someone else's.
Most people are in favor of brevity as long as it is somebody else's. Truer words have probably never been spoken. I love. Did you hear him say, "Be a good boy"? I just love. It's just so funny to see how things go. And order. That would be quite interesting if we tried that sometime in here. But true words. If you see the British House of Commons, or perhaps you have seen other examples in our own House of Representatives that has over 400 members, so even way more than we saw there, order at times can be really hard to maintain. And when it's hard to maintain, when everyone's talking over each other, when one person thinks it's more important for me to be heard than for anyone else to be heard, hardly anything productive can get done at all. That's in a secular governing body, right? What about when that happens in a church body? What about if that happens in a Sunday gathering like this, when there's no order in a church? What about when everyone in a Sunday gathering thinks they should be heard over everyone else? Well, that's a form of what Paul is talking about today. So here's our key takeaway for this morning. It's on the back of the bulletin there. It'll be on the screen there behind me. It's the main thing we're seeing in the scripture today. So here it is. Everything done in a public worship gathering like this of the church should be executed as orderly as possible, with the goal of maximum encouragement and understanding for all present. Pretty simple today, probably pretty straightforward for most of us, but we'll take a look at how Paul says it and figure it out. So this morning, we've got some very practical instructions. If you're a practical person, we're getting practical here this morning, that should be very applicable to our own Sunday gatherings that we do here, like what we're doing. It's also probably very applicable to our own community groups when we start those up again, and to the prayer group that we have going on right now as well. And in the middle of this section, though, you probably noticed quite an interesting detour that Paul takes, speaking specifically to an issue of men and women in the church. It's even for someone who studies the Bible on a regular basis, it kind of strikes you in 2021 in a strong way, but we'll try to tackle that and see the cultural context, and then the passage sums up at the end with kind of the main theme and the main takeaways on what we should see from the public worship gathering. And probably this section kind of wraps up all of chapters 12 through 14 as we've been talking about the public worship gathering like this. So first, look with me at the first few verses, starting in verse 26. Get the practical instructions for our gathering. Look at how it begins again. Paul says, "What then, brothers and sisters?" Again, that word brothers in Greek is an inclusive word. It is a masculine one, but it would in that context mean everyone. So we could probably translate brothers and sisters. "When you come together, each one has a hymn, a lesson, a revelation, a tongue, or interpretation. Let all things be done for building up." That final sentence there could really sum up all of Paul's instructions for this whole section. What is the church gathering for? What is the Sunday worship service for? What are we doing? We know the theme of what we're to celebrate. We're to celebrate the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus for us, the good news of what he has done. But what's the rest? What should form how we celebrate that, how we do it? What should it look like? Conversely, what should other gatherings that the church holds look like? Our community groups, our kind of small groups that we have together. What should prayer meetings have, like the ones we're having and hosting weekly at Alex's place today? Paul says, let all things, all these gatherings that we have, be done for building up. They are for building up. They are for encouragement. The Sunday worship gathering is for coming together as one, as much as possible, and encouraging and building up one another. therefore bringing unity as we meet together under the banner of the good news of the Lord Jesus. And it's for people who are not yet followers of Jesus to come and see us be a part of that unified vision and unified work that we're doing together. What is one thing that you could pray as you step into a worship service at 10 a.m. here on Sundays? You could pray, Lord, help us, help me today build up others this morning as I'm a part of this worship service. Help me encourage someone in their walks with Jesus in any way that I can. It's for folks in here who don't yet follow Jesus as well to be encouraged themselves. And we hope, our hope is that people would come in off the street, people would see us online as we invite friends to start coming with us. Again, everything's kind of in flux. I just saw a big survey by Lifeway, which is a research arm, and it said the confidence for going into gatherings like this is going down again for Americans as the Delta variant goes up. So I think it's going to be a long process as we all figure out how to do this stuff again, especially in somewhere like LA. But as we have friends come in, we hope they would not just be encouraged and come away feeling better, they'd be encouraged to follow Jesus and put their trust in him and what he's done for them. That's what Sundays are for, building one another up. Now, notice something interesting here about how Paul describes their gathering taking place here. This seems, in a lot of ways, when I read this on the surface, seems pretty different than our Sunday worship gatherings, right? The standard, at least American, Christian Sunday worship service kind of looks very different than what Paul describes here, right? It seems a whole lot more participatory, right, for the whole congregation than our standard worship service gathering is. There are probably a ton of reasons for that, many of them including what the history of the church the last 2,000 years has been, how the church has kind of morphed and changed and developed. You know, back then there were no church buildings you could meet in. It was very rare to have bigger buildings like this that you could rent out that weren't already reserved for something else, and this new religion wouldn't want to have some new religion hosted in their temple or whatever. So there just weren't opportunities to have larger gatherings of people. You know, after Pentecost, the first church became an instant megachurch. There were 3,000 people at least that became followers of Jesus that first day of Pentecost. So you automatically had all these people, but probably everything had to be done in smaller groups. So that's what we see taking place here. There's other reasons our service doesn't look like Paul describes here. Probably a lot of it cultural, some of it preference, some denominational, all sorts of things. But by all accounts, what Paul describes for their Sunday gathering, we've said this before, could probably be much more applicable to our community groups, for instance, when we are together in those. Why do I say that? Well, Paul in verse 26 says, each one has a hymn, a lesson, a revelation, a tongue, or an interpretation. It's really fascinating to me anyway. Paul doesn't say, if the worship leader comes up and has a hymn he's going to lead us in this morning, he says, here are the songs we are going to lead. It doesn't say, if the pastor or the elder gets up and he's got a lesson, he's got a key takeaway he's giving everyone this morning. Paul says, each one has. With an apparent real expectation that many people in the worship service would participate vocally in this Sunday gathering, in singing, in teaching, and of course, the other gifts that they exercise. Again, I think this is probably a lot more analogous to our community groups, where in our community groups, everyone that wants to has a chance to talk. Everyone that wants to has a chance to share, has a chance to request prayer if they want, has a chance to pray themselves, has a chance to say, you know, I think this might be saying, and then kind of move on with that. So that's probably more what this looks like for us. But what does Paul say about all of this? He says, whoever speaks up, whoever decides to participate vocally, let all of it be done with order, right? Let it be done for encouragement of others. He again discourages tongues to an extent, right? We looked at that last week together. He kind of does it again. Here he says he limits it most to two, maybe three, and there's a requirement also for there to be an interpreter if someone's going to do this. Again, the fascinating thing about that, just kind of a side note as we looked at last week, this again assumes that if someone is speaking in a tongue, they're in full control of their bodies. Sometimes if you go to more charismatic services or you see different traditions practicing this gift of tongues today, people can almost seem kind of totally out of themselves almost. This assumes, Paul says, hey, if you're going to do it, you need to make sure here are the qualifications, but if not, be quiet. It assumes people are in control of themselves when they do that. So he limits that, and then again, he encourages prophecy. He says there should be examination of the prophecy. Let people prophesy. Let them share what's going on. Notice again in verse 30 that order and deference to others is the priority in a worship service. Verse 30, Paul says, if a revelation is made to another sitting there, let the first be silent, for you can all prophesy one by one so that they all may learn and all may be encouraged. It appears that standing in the early church, we can get a picture of the normal setting would have been everyone sitting down somehow, probably leaning. There was often common to lean at a table or a couch type area. And then we can assume, it sounds like from here, standing up would be a way to signify, I've got something to say to this matter. I've got a prayer to offer. I've got a hymn that I think we should sing together. And it was a signal, it seems, from this, that God was convincing someone that they need to get up and share something with the rest of the congregation. Again, probably a way of going, you know, in a community group, I think I want to share X, Y, or Z about this. And you had to pray or prophesy or something. So Paul says, if one person is sharing, going on, and another gets up while that person is sharing, the other person talking should then sit down and be quiet and let the new person standing give whatever word they have to give. Now, as I'm thinking about this, this is pretty funny, at least to me. That seems like a really good way, if someone's going on and on for a long time, to like cut them off right away, right? You know, I can imagine someone's going on for too long and you go, you know, poke someone else and say, hey, Joe, Gary's talking way too long. Can you get up and like say a closing prayer or something? And Paul says, well, if someone gets up in the middle, you got to sit down after that. But we should at least take away from this. I don't think that's what Paul's saying, if someone's long-winded, that you should then stand up and cut them off. But this does carry an assumption that God doesn't just speak through the leaders of the church, right? That God doesn't just speak through the worship leaders when they lead on stage. God doesn't just speak through the pastor or whoever's giving a message on stage. God doesn't just speak through the person leading a prayer time or leading a community group. He speaks through all of us, and we need to defer to one another if there's something someone has to share or wants to pray, so that, Paul says, we could all be encouraged. He says all of that can be done in time. We don't need to rush. The point is that we all have order, that we all be encouraged, and we all do it for the good of everyone, not just the good of yourself. Well, the final line of this section makes it clear in verse 33. It says, for God is not a God of confusion, but of peace. Again, we get the emphasis on order. Now, before we get to the difficult, hard detour that takes place here, we have a problem. Verse 33 in the English Standard Version, which we are looking at and reading from today, you'll notice is, for God's not a God of confusion, but of peace, as in all the churches of the saints. Verse 34 starts with, the women should keep silent. You may see the issue there already. Does the end of verse 33 go with what precedes it or what comes after it? Now, you may or may not know, the original language, it actually makes a difference which one you put it with, right? The original ancient Greek language doesn't have our modern style of punctuation, doesn't have our modern paragraph structure and things. So sometimes in cases like this, interpretive choices have to be made with, does this go with what precedes it or does it go with after it? I'm inclined, based on the context, to kind of go with the numbering of the verses that were done here, that it goes with the rest of verse 33. The thing that is true then in all the churches is that God is a God not of confusion but of peace. Does that make sense? Which is why this order and these three chapters, 12, 13, and 14, we've been focusing on, matter so much for public worship like this. And thus, the new paragraph, I think, my opinion, not God's word, God's final word on it, but my opinion is that 34 starts a new paragraph. But reasonable minds can disagree. But if that's accurate, then verses 34 and 35 should probably be thought of as kind of an aside that Paul thought, oh, here's another issue that could distract, here's another thing that could lead to things going out of order in a church service. So I'm going to mention this kind of on the side because it seems really clear in verse 36. It kind of picks up the theme from verse 33. This really seems like a insert into here and moving on to other stuff as he goes back to the overall order. But boy, this aside of verses 34 and 35 is difficult for modern American Christian ears in 2021. Or at least it's difficult for me. I don't think I'm the only one that reads this and goes, oof, what does that exactly mean? Because that sounds very interesting. On the surface, probably to modern American ears, this sounds somewhat sexist, honestly, doesn't it? That's how it probably comes off to your common Angelino in 2021. It sounds to modern ears as if women are inferior to men and need to learn only at home, while men have the real knowledge that can be sought out and they have the real opportunity to speak up. If that was the case, it would be very conflicting for us because it would seem that the scripture is somehow encouraging some form of sexism, which then we would say probably falls into some sort of sin, but we know the Word of God never encourages us to sin. Sure, there's lots of accounts of sin in Scripture, right? There's all sorts of stories of Satan and his demons and the evil that they do. There's all sorts of failures of people and all sorts of terrible things that take place, but the Scripture never commends for us to sin or for people, for instance, to do something that is particularly sexist and as if to treat women as if they are inferior to men. So we got to ask, what is going on here? Well, I think this is another section where the cultural context we have to know to really understand what is going on here, and hopefully will help us. So let me give a little of that as we continue. The Greco-Roman world at this time, in which Corinth, this city that this church is in, the Greco-Roman world that Corinth existed in, though cosmopolitan, though progressive for its own day, was still very often extremely different in the way men and women were viewed in their roles in society, okay? Particularly in terms of what was taboo between men and women, especially between men, married men, and married women or women who were not married to that particular man. Here's how theologian Christian Forbes helps us out with some of the contextual work that he's done. He says, in the Greco-Roman world, it was considered scandalous for a married woman to carry on a conversation with another woman's husband. There existed in the Greco-Roman world in our period a strong prejudice against women speaking in public, and especially against their speaking to other women's husbands. In a society with strictly defined gender and social roles and a strong view of the rights of a man over his wife, such behavior was treated as totally inappropriate. Okay, so that could sort of give us some of the context of what Paul is addressing here. Let me give you a first century person, someone who lived in that day that we've translated some of their words, a first century Greco-Roman witness in their own words to enlighten more before returning back to Paul's words to see what he says. So this is a very famous guy named Plutarch. If you've heard about him, he was a first century Roman and Greek historian and philosopher. Here's what he said in telling a story. He said, not only the arm of a virtuous woman should be hidden from view, but her speech as well should be hidden. Ought not to be for the public. She ought to be modest and guarded about saying anything in the hearing of outsiders. Again, this is a non-Christian historian, right? Since it is an exposure of herself, for in her talk can be seen her feelings, character, and disposition. For a woman ought to do her talking either to her husband or through her husband, and she should not feel aggrieved about it. Like the flute player, she makes a more impressive sound through the tongue, not her own. Again, that's Plutarch. Again, us reading those words go, well, it takes us aback. Who are you, Plutarch, to say this? But if we're going to understand what Paul is writing to, this is the world that he is speaking into. So there are lots more examples we could pull from and that I tried to look up in reading this and understanding it. But it is clear, in the first century Greco-Roman world, it was taboo, it was out of bounds, it was seen as an affront for everyone for a woman to speak to another man or question another man in public, especially if that was a married man who was not their own husband's. Why? Well, much of it probably had to do with views of modesty and impropriety, but also there was no reality of a common ancient woman ever being as learned as a common ancient man. So the whole structure of society was not set up. The whole system was not set up to educate girls at all. And so there was no opportunity for further education of women. There was no societal structure that would allow women to be able to further their education in any form. So by the time they were married and older, they were expected in society to learn from their husbands, whom which the whole society was set up to educate the boys and educate the men. And so they had been educated in greater society. They would be then able to answer the questions that the ladies might have. That, of course, is not our world today, right? I'm thankful for that. More on that in a minute. So, what then does this mean? What is Paul saying for us? Help us out, DJ. The Pillar commentary series that I've been reading from throughout the series says it again for us. That a woman should not interrogate or ask embarrassing questions of or regarding her own husband in public would have been intuitively known to something everyone kind of understood with any social sensitivity at all in Paul's world. So, it is clear from earlier in 1 Corinthians, both men and women were encouraged in the church to exercise the gift of prophecy. It was expected, if we looked at what happened before, men and women would pray. In fact, we had that whole section earlier about women should pray with their head covered or whatever. But it assumed there would be prayer and prophecy taking place from both men and women. So Paul is not forbidding all speech by anyone who is female in a church gathering. Because of the greater social taboo, though, in that culture, of a woman speaking out of turn, especially addressing or questioning the husband of another woman, in that society, because that would be so taboo, Paul forbids it as well in the worship gathering. Okay, probably a cultural thing going on. The type of questioning, what it is, should not be done, he says. It would be scandalous to other non-Christians outside who would enter a gathering and they see that going on. They go, this is not a place of decent people in society. And Paul says it should be scandalous as well to followers of Jesus in their own worship gathering. So it would be so distracting to the worship gathering that, like someone babbling on in their own tongues, doing their own things so loudly that everyone's like, geez, I'm trying to focus on Jesus here, and we got Fred over here who won't shut up all on his own, and we have no idea what he's saying. Paul's saying the same sort of thing could happen if people are getting up and causing such a disturbance because they're doing something so culturally taboo that it takes everyone out of being able to focus on Jesus and what he's doing in the worship service together. How do we apply this to our own day? Do we live in a world where it is taboo for married women to talk to other married men? No, for the most part, right? It is not strange. I was talking to Dre this morning. I was talking to others this morning, you know, not weird at all. It could be weird, right? We could imagine a scenario if one married man was meeting privately all the time with another married woman to someone else. We would probably start to go, what's going on there? That's probably not good overall if there's constant one-on-one meetings between some married man and another married woman. We might start to go, what's going on there? Also, beyond that though, not strange for men and women to interact and talk in our society about all sorts of things. Also, our entire educational system, right, is built around, hopefully, ideally, educating both girls and boys equally. There are tons of opportunities and so many fewer barriers for women to pursue master's and PhD education. So much so that it would be nothing for us, be nothing for Americans, that there would be an American woman who is more of an expert in X, Y, or Z category than many men, right? That would not be a strange thing at all. So the cultural taboo that led Paul to address this really doesn't apply to us today. Does that make sense? Hopefully it does. This is hard. So, how could we apply this instruction from Paul? Well, no one, neither men nor women today, should do something for us in our worship gathering that is so culturally taboo that it distracts everyone else from being able to worship, being able to be encouraged, and being able to learn about Jesus. So imagine a scenario like this. Imagine in the middle of my sermon right now, someone goes up and goes, "Excuse me, DJ, excuse me, sir. I have a question about something you just said, and I'd like to interrupt you and talk it over, and then you can return to whatever you're talking about." The rest of you automatically, because it's a cultural thing that we don't, you know, you don't think about, but wouldn't you automatically like tense up and go, "Oh, this is awkward. Why is this dude standing up in the middle of the service interrupting the message?" It would be so disruptive to the rest of the worship gathering that it would take people out. That's probably what Paul is forbidding here. That type of thing should not happen. Or imagine Steve is leading worship and someone does this. "Hold up, stop worshiping. I've got a question about the lyric there. I don't understand what's being talked about right there. Can you please interrupt this worship service? I need to know what that," again, we would be like, "What is going on? This is very strange." It would take everyone else out of focusing on Jesus. That would be something that would be much better to do after the service, right? Go up to Steve, say, "Hey, this lyric is weird. Can you explain what the heck is going on there? Or, hey, when you said this in the sermon, that didn't make sense. Can we talk?" That's probably what Paul is doing here. And what, if we take this 2,000 years of cultural distance between us and Corinth, what we could take away from this. All right, let's, as we finish, bring it back to the main theme, starting again in verse 36, the final paragraph here. We'll close with this. Paul has a strong word to give those who might partake in selfishly distracting others with tongues or speaking out of turn or monopolizing the worship gathering. The Pillar Commentary paraphrases verse 36's questions this way. "Surely," Paul would say, "you don't think the word of God originated with you, do you? Surely you don't think you're the only people it has reached, do you?" Meaning, God speaks through lots of people, right? Not just you. So, homie that wants to monopolize the gathering with your prayer or with your word of prophecy or with your special tongue, don't you understand? God's word comes through lots of people, through all his people, Corinthians. Those who think you're the only ones who've unlocked the keys to the kingdom and should speak above everyone else, so much to distract and monopolize the worship gathering, you need to be humbled to understand the word of God itself is living and active. It did not originate with you, does not come from you. It comes from the Holy Spirit. And he speaks through his people at different times. So in verse 38, Paul warns that people who ignore this instruction and press on in division and press on in selfishness and monopolizing will in the end be ignored by God themselves, which is a strong warning that we should go, "Okay, I should try not to do that then." What's the point? Verses 39 and 40 sum it all up. "So my brothers and sisters, earnestly desire to prophesy and do not forbid speaking in tongues, but all things should be done decently and in order." Again, if you want to go back and go, what's prophecy, what's tongues, the message last week, we kind of covered that all together. So make sure you go back on YouTube or SoundCloud and listen to that for that. So we are here every Sunday or online when we can't meet in person. We're here for encouragement, right? We are here because we need each other. But more than that, we are here because we need Jesus. And we come and gather to hear from him, from his word, to hear him speak through us to one another. We are his body. Remember, Paul has talked about earlier. We're different than one another. We are different parts than one another. Some of us are hands. Some of us are eyes. Some of us are mouths. Some of us are arms, feet, and on and on and on. And we need each other for this work of encouragement and pointing one another to Jesus together. So we come to celebrate his life, death, and resurrection for us and for the world. But none of that can happen if everyone comes to the gathering on Sunday mornings determined to serve themselves, right? None of that can happen if we're looking into what's in it for me during this whole thing instead of how can I build up others? How can I help other people see Jesus as I try to see him together this morning? None of it can happen if we monopolize the gathering, but if we all seek to build others up when we come together, if we all seek to help people understand Jesus more at the Sunday gathering, at community groups, at prayer time, if we all seek to be a blessing to others, not seeking first to be heard, but to hear from one another, and most of all to hear from Jesus, then we will do well. All things should be done decently and in order. Let all things be done for building up. Amen. May God help us to do that. Let's pray. Father, thanks so much for clear words. Besides the aside part that's a little hard to figure out, the rest of it is probably pretty clear and pretty practical and easy for us to understand. Thank you that you are a God of order. Thank you that there's not some mystical key that we need to unlock that only a certain few people can get, and there's only certain people who can learn, and there's only some people who get the Holy Spirit, and everyone else has to depend on them. You are a God who speaks to all of us. You're a God who gives the Holy Spirit to all of us. You are a God who speaks, who moves us to pray, who moves us to love one another, moves us to encourage one another. Help us to live that out as we come to these gatherings, as we come to community groups when we have them, as they come to prayer meetings, and any other time we come together. Help us to come for order and for encouragement of all as we celebrate, Jesus, what you've done for us. In your name we pray. Amen.